Oh, rolling.
There's a very broad proposal to allow text and data mining. No specifics are given. They basically say that researchers may need to have the ability to basically copy large chunks of content for text and data mining, and this furthers the purposes of a Singapore Smart Nation initiative, although again they don't give an example, so they sort of throw these buzzwords out there. Point here is that they've given some examples, you know, so they said this is not intended to be used whereby you copy, let's say, competitors' information or content, and you do no analysis, that would be infringement. But if you do an analysis, it would fall within the exception. So you sort of come into the situation, and they don't give any guidance as what analysis is required. They just say analysis here. And the text and data mining, the output can be used for commercial purposes. It's not limited to non-commercial. So it's actually quite far-reaching. And my view is that this possibly, if you know, is already covered under fair use exceptions already, and perhaps could be made an example under the current fair use
suggestion
examples, as opposed to making it a specific exception. Thoughts?
The question I have with fair use was, there was an issue of percentage, right? How much are you using from a fair use point of view?
No.
How much of whatever, 10%, 5%, 30% of whatever I'm using with fair use? I mean, that's the US model, isn't it?
There's a definition of reasonable portion of a work.
Reasonable.
It's like a deeming thing, right? If it's later we go to educational.
So therefore, 10%. In this case, data learning will be more than that.
No, so you only use your general principle, and then now that then if you put an example that data mining is okay, then there's no percentage.
Fair use can have substantial copying, and you can still be fair use. The court will consider all the circumstances.
So Brian, the point that you're making is not to say that data analysis will necessarily be fair use, but rather data analysis will not be an infringement to the extent that you can show that a particular
instance
party seeking to exercise or to use that to use the data for data analysis can establish a fair use.
Yep, agree.
I just have a simple suggestion. I think we should start with a definition of what data analysis and data mining is. Either a definition or illustrations. And because when we went for the roundtable SME, we raised this question, but nobody seemed to have a satisfactory answer. And MinLaws agreed in. So I think that would be a good starting point. Because it can be very broad. For instance, does the definition of data analysis include accessing data on a query basis? Because they were giving some, I think one of the participants, she was giving some examples where certain software will, you know, you put in certain queries and it will analyze the data and pull out stuff for you. So that's incident. And then it will incidentally copy the data as it does so. So that's incidental copying, which is, yeah. Or does it have to be actual downloading of the material and then analyzing it, you know,
right.
Somebody does it deliberately. So these are the difficulties which arise, the technical aspects. And
if you follow what Brian is saying, I think what will happen then is you look at the use and then determine where it's fair use. So the greater the extent of mining and analysis, I think the greater the chance of that being fair use. If it's a single query, single field information that you're just pulling up, may not be.
Even meet the substantiality test.
Right. Yeah. Well, unfortunately, the more substantial the thinking here, the better.
Yeah, but the I think the intent here, coming from a software perspective, right? So if I know I have all this data that I can potentially do analysis with, and what should that be a new exception for copying? So I have. So what is it actually asking me to do? That I have to ask permission first before I do it, or is this meant to be available by default? Or
it's available. Well, it's arguably you can do it now. You can.
I mean, I can do it now. I mean,
right.
I pull the
it's
stuff.
Yours, it's yours. But let's say you want to use the government property prices database.
Yeah. So for example, I mean, yeah. So taking
that,
so data.gov.sg, right? So the data is available there. They put it up, whatever permissions that they grant,
mm-hmm.
and then do whatever you want with it.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be no issue,
yeah.
right?
This release
that's already available. And then where is this going to be deemed new? That means you didn't explicitly state. So if I were to pull down websites, web pages for that matter, to do analysis or text analysis to see how frequently a particular word is being used or whatever it may be. I
think the issue could be if when you're doing the analysis or when the software which you're using is doing the analysis, if it copies stuff from
that's
that.
That's an algorithm, right? So I may choose to copy it first before I do it, or I can just, you know, do other ways to cache it temporarily.
Right.
That's how I want to do it. And you dictate how I do it based on
whether
it seems to be.
I don't know, can they dictate by...
Doesn't make sense, because then, I mean, then my efficiency as a developer is kind of reduced. I may choose the best path forward. Right? Sometimes I may do this, sometimes I do it another way. I may cache it because I got a slow bandwidth.
Mm-hmm.
I may not cache it because I got good bandwidth. So you can keep it there, I just query when I need to.
Right.
So it depends on how I do it, right? So
mm-hmm.
it varies.
So if you do have a fairly defense that you then have to prove, then all that becomes less certain, but either way,
it's available to you.
You look at the transaction as a totality, but not at the individual, you know, whether it's a query or do I pull the whole database and then analyze that and throw it back.
The challenge with some of these is it's because you just use the word database, whole database, unlikely that I will pull down a database because I generally don't have access to the database. I usually access a so-called database via some kind of an API and application
mm-hmm.
programming interface.
Right.
So very rarely, or if at all,
mm-hmm.
can I query and return 100% of everything. It's only a subset. Give me all the dates of, you know, books being checked out or addresses
mm-hmm.
in this particular postal code or whatever it is. And so I only get a very, very defined subset of replies. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
So unlikely I ever get the whole thing.
Sure.
So,
oh yeah, unless you're Aaron Schwartz.
No, but yeah, so no, that again,
yeah.
I can download chunk by chunk, I can do that, right?
Mm.
So it takes a much longer period to get it done. But I don't know this one. I'm struggling trying to figure out what is it that we're trying to solve by.
See, that's the thing, they don't give it really, you know,
they gave an example
which is kind of like, that's
not nation.
It's a very man. No, they gave like, all right.
Mutu works
in Mutu. Media monitoring company, you know,
it's like
it doesn't help that they don't have proposed how it's going to rephrase the actual,
because it's conceptual only right now,
but again,
so,
then
right.
if we are struggling with this as in, some tech experts here, then how much so
the example they gave is to collate all the social media and food blog posts, you know. And
sort of like news aggregation,
kind
of thing.
And then it says here that he makes a copy
of
all the posts and reviews, and he analyzes the data. And you know, he could actually now be liable to all the copyright owners who made the comments.
Wow.
Post comments,
Facebook, Twitter.
You know, when you're putting aside all the other values and all that, it just says that. So with this, they're saying that Mutu would. Can safely go and aggregate all the comments.
This one actually, to me, right, look at the example, it strikes me as something quite similar to the transformative use
mm-hmm.
principle, where you are actually just taking without permission, but you use it in a new way, which is beneficial, and because of that, it's a fair... You know, it's a fair use. The only thing is that it's specific to data mining. So do we need something like that specific to data and text mining? Or can it fall under like a nature and character of use, which is trans- some material. And again, maybe an illustration would be more useful, and then park it under Section 35. Unless you can really come up with something that's a clause, a provision that makes sense. Because now it's just, especially when I look at 3.63, it's really like a policy thing. We want Singapore to be a smart nation, so we want to do this, but how the provision is going to appear is going to be the difficult thing. So rather than have a provision, say, this is one possible, you know,
example
of fair use, fair dealing, and put it under.
So this one is only talking about data as in textual only. Is it specific?
That's the data. I don't think any just text and data.
It's
so I
was.
No, that's why you say text and data because text exists as data. So.
So I think data is wider. I mean, but my is
everything.
Obviously, a technical person.
Yeah, it's a very
Drafted
by
law.
So
it's sorry. So there's no definition.
Yeah. Because then you have images, you've got audio, you've got video, everything's data.
I think
so
data is wider, the definition.
Very wide.
It's wider.
Data is text, photos, video, sound recording.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. The purpose is for the data analysis.
So they're looking at focusing on the purpose, not on the
purpose.
Data
exactly.
Itself,
exactly.
What data is.
Yeah.
And I think, like you said, it's a policy. I think they were.
It's a policy. We come from the policy where we want.
Yeah.
Want to be a smart nation and everything, so we want this, but
exactly.
Then how it's going to look, we don't know, because if you look at the first part, you also see new and still evolving research tools, so if you want to make it tech neutral, you can't have a very specific clause, so why make a specific clause? And
so it must like keep you under the example that you suggested.
Make the illustration.
Yeah, and it's more flexible that way, because if you have a clause like that, anyway, you probably have to amend it later on, unless you have it, which is wide, but if it's too wide, then it's big. And again, then maybe it's better as illustration. I don't know, that's my view.
So the question is, should there be a new exception? I mean, I take the view that this is an existing exception already that's within the FBI.
It could be an existing exception. And
yes,
to make it clearer, we make an illustration.
Yeah.
Just like parody is a tire and anything of that sort.
Yeah, that makes more sense. Okay. Ben,
you're going to
vote?
Okay, let's take a vote now. All those in favor of, you know, frame the question. On creating all those in favor of the new exception. All those in favor of allowing data analysis.
So put it in an example.
As an illustration.
Illustration.
Okay.
I think the position is that it's already an existing exception, but that it should be framed under
qualified and subject to you being able to establish.
Yeah. But you put it in illustration, actually saying that we, the legislators, recognize it as a potential fairness. I mean, subject to the fairness.
It has to be. Commercial exploitation, surely that cannot be right.
Yeah, yeah. No, you still have to look at the fairness of the use. But by putting it in illustration, at least we're acknowledging that, okay, this is something.
You have a look at the screen. Is that representing what we're thinking?
No.
There should be examples.
Under Section 35, I think it's clear. Just put a provision.
Section 35.
Then that part is
examples or illustrations of
data mining.
Text and data mining, yeah.
Rather than standalone provisions.
Yeah.
Instead of a standalone exception.
And then that's it. Standalone. Auto correct. Okay.
And we can delete everything after the comment.
Okay. Whether it's in the rules or not, doesn't matter.
I'm just, what's not very clear from this is whether they want text and data mining, this exception to be for commercial or non-commercial. That one's not very clear here. Based on the illustration, it seems that even commercial text data mining is okay.
Yes.
So they want to enable new businesses.
Yeah,
enable
new ideas. But
there's a side.
The data
always
will be
right. Yeah. They will be. But I mean, this is still rough. We should expect them to still further refine.
So there needs to be this balance, right? Because if you go completely the other way, then you know you may say you're a smart nation, but all the data guys will pull out the databases.
Mm.
So it's important, what are you advising it for?
So,
it's a very case-by-case basis.
So it's acceptable data mining.
To determine what are you analyzing it for, what data are you taking?
Just the example seems to presuppose a commercial.
That's right. The example suggests that they're presupposing that this is so wide as to allow commercial use, then why should it be that the commercial search provider can charge a fee, making it's almost a parasitic use of the data, right? The original data. It's fundamentally, that's not, doesn't seem quite right. If I have data that's subject to protection anyway, then this use that you're making of my data should be something that I have some recognized revenue for.
But how much have you modified that data? I mean, same thing we can argue about search engines. They're actually using everybody's or social networks. They're using everybody's data, but they're using it.
But if the data is there, the information is there, the patterns are being mined through the use of an algorithm. So it's equally the same thing, right? Why should the search provider, the guys who got out the algorithm, have 100% of income? Because the results are really a reflection of algorithm put onto the data. The two needed to be the inputs to get to your final outcome.
But the difficulty with that is identifying the owner of the data as well, right? Because they aggregate from numerous sources. So who's to say?
But the width of this is actually scary, if you think about it. Because on the one hand, you could have Google Books all over again, right? The entire Penguin and all North American publishers, or for that matter, all publishers of the world, their books end up there, being analyzed and searched.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's
exactly. So that's why I said the exception would not differentiate between commercial and non-commercial activity, which means the final analysis can be commercialized.
So if you are say, you know, you come up with some kind of AI search engine that can draw the connections, pulling through an entire library of human knowledge, right? Say in a British library collection, then what? Is it right that the guys whose data is mined don't get paid?
An example is where someone copies the works to collate into a large database for sale as a service without doing any analysis on it. That's where they're saying you can't do it. You must do some analysis.
Although there will always be analysis.
That's right. What is
the fact you put it together means that analysis really.
Yeah.
No, but if you just pull out and say, okay, you're looking for this book, here's the book. Then there's no analysis there.
Is
but
like a combination?
If you're looking for a topic and they take out all the knowledge and put it side by side for you.
But that's precisely why we cannot have a standalone provision. That it has to be, you have to really look at that case and see what is it. Is it just doing something that's.
Junior's position is that even
shouldn't have
an illustration would be opening the floodgates to.
So if.
No, I think it has got to be really,
If anything at all is illustration,
it has to be
narrow.
You've got to establish that whatever you're taking is can constitute a value. So you don't have a standalone.
Yeah, so it's the same. That means you're agreeing that it shouldn't be a provision. It should be some factor that's subject still to a fairness analysis, looking at the factors and additional factors that you're
not. Certainly not like what we have today for research and study, where it is a deemed category, of value.
But research and studies, you still have to look at. You still have to look at the fairness.
I think it says it includes research and study or something like that.
Yeah, under section 35.1a, but then you still have to look at the factors.
Well, whatever it is, I think we should be clear.
Yeah.
Okay, if added in at the bottom, it must still be subject to fair use factors.
Yeah.
Okay. Last one.
Would you be opposed to commercializing the results of the book?
I think it's too amorphous right now.
Fair use allows you to,
but it's a factor again.
It
could go against you. It's too exploitative.
They can
say that it's too exploitative and it shouldn't be.
It could be transformative.
Yeah, but if it's very transformative, then it means go ahead. Which I think what the government wants, which is.
We don't have any recognition of transformative use, right?
Yeah, we don't.
No, there isn't, because it could be anything. could be any type of.
No, but no case law.
In the US, the cases are your.
In Singapore is not.
Singapore?
Yeah. But it's part under the first factor. So our first factor can be read, potentially read to include these kinds of.
Is the phrase transformative actually?
It's not there. But the phrase transformative is also not in the US provision, but they read it under the nature and purpose of
the work.
The work. Under first factor. So they read the first factor as including, you know, if you change the nature and purpose of the work, then that's transformative, and that's something that we put a lot of weight to because it has social benefits and everything. And in Singapore's case, I guess public benefits as
yeah,
well.
This whole thing about transformative use, I think we've got to track very carefully because it's not known in Singapore jurisprudence.
Yeah, and that's why illustrations are good. And rather than to put just add in the word transformative, it's not going to be helpful. But
the word innovative use.
But I see any single word will be difficult.
Yeah.
Just like data mining
in
itself, you don't know.
Because we will unduly limit the scope.
Yeah. So that's the benefit of illustrations, although the pros and cons.
Okay. So are we where are we now?
PPMs.
Educational users actually is quite straightforward because there are a few questions. The first one is, should there be a new exception for non-profit educational institutions for giving or receiving instructions? Really to acknowledge that the provisions currently, as the currently drafted, is very much geared towards educators copying information, sharing it with the students, but the way that we teach now in tertiary institutions and probably also going down, you know, from what I know of the JCs and even secondary schools, there's a lot of peer-to-peer kind of learning, so the materials can be shared among students, between students, so it's not really a one-way, one-direction thing. So to me, you know, yeah, that should be the case, actually. There should be an exception for to expand, you know, what it means by giving and receiving instruction. I mean, this is very, very much related to the other question, which is the one on whether exception for insubstantial copying has to be from a premises of a non-profit educational institution.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really assign work all the time sitting in my office. I could be somewhere else assigning the work because the provision as it currently stands, section 51, I think, states that it has to be from the premises. It's a very long question. So it's really not, I don't think it's a very controversial one. Those who attended any other talks, they didn't really spend a lot of time. Because to me, it's really just updating to take into account
the realities,
of modern teaching.
One question in my mind when I first saw this was the idea of a non-profit education. So as opposed to a profitable education, so
it's
talking about
been
private.
It's
always been like that.
So a private school.
I didn't even know that.
Private schools don't have.
I think the one
question. Doesn't apply to private schools.
The one question which came up with respect to this phrase non-profit was what happens when non-profit educational institutions provide executive courses where, which are really for-profit, not so much non-profit. Would those be covered? That might be one question. So then we need to define what non-profit.
So
that's
what about those tuition teachers? You know, they may
those are profit.
Those
well,
are
no,
those
individual
profit.
Individual teachers, right?
Yeah.
Individual, not in a tuition center, right?
Yeah.
They do stuff. How?
They're not institution.
Yeah.
So they are definitely for profit. Definitely for profit. So it won't cover them because they're making money, so to speak. But the line between making money and not really,
that's okay.
Let's say like. I'm sure SMU also does, and most polytechnics run programs where they make money.
Yeah.
Professional development programs where we have.
Yeah, but the money again goes back to institutions, so I think an overall view is not considered to be profit-making. Do you think it's more useful if they actually have subsidy legislation which lists out what is, rather than to define it, to list up, which is quite common.
What if external traders coming in?
Non-profit institutions include these.
So you have Gazette all the
And you can apply if you feel that you deserve to be on the list.
Yes.
I mean, what about, you know, foreign universities that establish campuses here, would they be considered profit or non-profit? If they are state universities, for example, in the country they are from.
Yeah, they're doing business here.
No, but yeah, is that considered doing business here?
Like your Duke NUS or...
Yeah, like Duke NUS or, you know, like John
Cook.
James Cook. So are they considered non-profit?
So I think Warren's idea, I think at least is better.
You know, if it's I think it's the kind of joint venture, then you really have to look at the case. But if it's a foreign university setting a private school here or something, then it's not likely to be. But for clarity purposes, maybe it's good to, rather than to define, because you can't define.
Yeah.
Because like we stated, we do earn money too, but it's just that it goes back into the organization. And universities all have this fund, reserve fund, just in case, in the red, and it goes back. So,
they should be listed in rules of regulations for clarity. Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Are there any situations
to provide an exception in this? It's not about tuition teachers.
Child care centers,
private tuition teachers.
Child care centers, all not.
Yeah. Situations.
Sweet tea.
This one, right, it's quite wide. I was thinking what can fall under this.
I thought it would like cover the tutorial videos that you post as an individual.
It could be any, because now again when you teach there's a lot of different ways and so it's meant to.
So you like user generated tutorials.
Yeah, user generated tutorials. Because I do that and I'm not an institution, so
And even tutor generated, professor generated.
Yeah. If I have a Patreon subscription, thank you very much.
Ooh, if you have a Patreon, you will be for profit.
Educational purposes.
Then after
I think educational purpose also can be, because okay, just to give an example, like we have student events, so they're not really classroom teaching like camps, etc. So students come up with their own material.
Yeah.
They need to use videos, movies to screen.
Yeah.
But when they come to us as advisors, we would tell them, don't do it. Please don't do it. It could be, you know, it may not be. So there needs to be some clarity on whether those are for educational purpose. They are for development of the students.
So, but again, I think the examples were that, student instructions or student presentations where they do research and they present in class and it's part of the learning process. And the facilitators usually are there to make sure they're correct or ask questions. So in that kind of situation, I feel that that's supposed to cover it.
I think Ankur is talking about, let's say you have a prom.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
Yeah, like a concert.
Mm. Oh. You want to play song?
That's right. You want to book the whole lecture theater.
Which is a common retro.
Now, what's considered educational? Maybe?
Yeah, it's happening on the premises of the lecture. But it's not really educational in that strict sense.
Mm-hmm.
But again, judging from what something that you do outside of class may be educational, but so the physical premise may not be. The important thing is what you're doing. So,
so
to me, if you're doing a D&D or whatever, and I don't. That's not educational.
Graduation.
So it's.
Can you have a graduation ball somewhere and then?
Isn't that part of the education?
Yeah.
Is it
I wouldn't read it as that way.
Right.
Educational purpose.
In order, you have to graduate as part of your education.
Then you would say anything done within educational premises or something to that
effect,
and you want to get away from the premise thing,
which
like
I have
from
heard.
Or on the premise. Of a non-profit agency, we said we are not tied to a particular place.
Mm-hmm.
So,
medically,
I wouldn't think it will extend to that.
But you see, I want to put it under 10B. So, for example, if we had a camp, right, and we had a camp outside, make it even harder. Have a camp outside because they have a lot of outdoor camps now. We go to Sembawang Park or we go to maybe somewhere in Sabah.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's part of the holistic education of the student today. And then in the process of that, if we take some copyright material, should we not have an exemption?
Mm. It's all in the purpose. The purpose is what it is. Right?
So if it's part of the cost of study, it's okay.
Purpose is
If it is. But if it's a social event, a mixer for orientation or something.
Yeah. But
it's
really
social.
It's part of the purpose, right?
So the building camaraderie, building friendship, building the bond.
You're thinking of the whole person, not just
the school as we err on the side of caution. This kind of thing you don't. Of course, that would be great, but I think it's a bit of a stretch to put it under educational. Again, it's a purpose-based thing. It's not an institution-based conception. So that's the difficulty. But I think it could also go towards, when you talk about situations, it could also go towards educational tools. I was wondering whether we can actually have a provision which talks about hyperlinking, to actually say hyperlinking in itself is not
deep linking, is it?
Yeah, it's not, you know.
That's how they can
infringement. Yeah, and that's in line with our law anyway on infringement. That if you put the link there and it links you to a pirated site, it's not considered to be the authorization of infringement.
That means it should not be explicit.
Sorry?
Because they say explicit allowed.
Other situations that we used to provide an exception for educational purposes. But will not be covered.
Expressly.
You might.
Yeah, take away the
expressly. So, I mean, it would be nice actually to have a provision that talks about trying hyperlinking and say that it's okay. Because there's a lot of these cases where they say it's okay in some situations and not in others. But different contexts, like for defamation, there's a set of rules about hyperlinking. Copyright.
Maybe an illustration, no? Yeah. Well, do you think that needs?
Yeah, we could have again, it's in answer to this question, but again, where that is put, where the exception comes in, that's the other question. Should it be under this provision, or again, it could be another illustration? That's question two. So you're breaking it up to two parts. One is, should we have something like this? And we identify something that we should have exception for, where should it be placed? Again. I think it can be a standalone because hyperlinking itself is really quite clear. And it's a tool that I use all the time.
Yeah, we use
it. I put links and say, you go and read that article. And I don't want to, situation. Just to make it very clear that it's allowed and it's not.
So we all agree. Okay, next.
Are you asking for?
But it's clearly allowed under education, but then if you're doing it for something else, then you can try under the.
So that should be moved to a fair use illustration, right?
Yes.
Or it can be under both. It could be clearly okay for education, but for other purposes, let's look at other factors, whether commercial or not.
Examples of fair use.
Both. I mean, I'm just giving one example, but you can think of other things to do with educational tools or situations, which is very wide. More than just tools, but
okay.
Maybe like you said earlier, does it include considerations of other not profit, maybe profit making?
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are 9:15 already.
Yeah, so I think we stay there for the moment. The last thing here that I just want to highlight is the one on standardizing the percentage. I'm fine with that. 10%.
Oh, yeah,
better than having a 10% here and 5% there.
Of course,
copyright owners may not be very.
The collection society will say, why not 5% and 5%?
It's exactly what they said at the last consultation.
But again, this one depends on who you are.
Yeah.
Which side you're on. I mean, to me, it's just standardize it, whether it's 5 or 10, but I would rather 10 as an educator.
The higher the threshold, the more use you have.
But having been part of the negotiation with the publisher, when we had the whole group, the fact is that the publisher has no idea anyway.
Yeah.
You just pick a number out which makes them feel comfortable.
That's true.
So when it's 5%, 10%, it's 3.3.
And then it goes to 10 bytes.
9.9%. I suspect the lower the percentage, the amount of work doesn't just double, triples, because you have a lot following.
Yeah.
Nobody's actually counting. Nobody's actually counting.
It's substantial. It's not.
They're plucking numbers out of the sky.
So 10% is okay.
10%.
Next was a question, team.
10C. That was 10C. 10B is actually related to what we said earlier. I think it's part of the whole. Shouldn't be confined to the premises, but you know, as long as for educational purposes, for in relation to a non-profit institution, yeah, you know, we assign work everywhere.
Okay, you okay, need
so
to see
one
the
more,
list.
Right?
Huh?
Yeah.
Circumvention. Okay.
Okay. The list is in the last slide,
yeah.
Harish.
Right.
Oh no.
Okay, I'm going to. Wait, let's do a.